Frank McDonough filling in for Jerry Turney. This is Gardens of California, and it is also called IDS 350. And we are live and online, and that means you can call at any time. And we're going to flash the number up on the screen that you can call. That's 1-800-339-1193. 1-800-339-1193. And again, I'm filling in for Jerry Turney, so if you're expecting Jerry, sorry, you got me. By the way, I'm a little sweaty here. I just came in from Fresno. Just came all the way in from Fresno. I was up near Shaver Lake. Besides gardening, I have another hobby, and that's cave exploring. I was up with a bunch of cave explorers for a big meeting of our region, and so I had to be there. But I was able to get here and filled in for Jerry too. So that explains the sweat on me right here. So, we are open for any and all gardening questions, so call in at 1-800-339-1193, 1-800-339-1193, and right now, we're going to be kind of focusing on lawns. There's an important subject in that we may not have lawns in Southern California as we know lawns today, so we're going to be looking at some of that, what's going to be taking place of lawns, what you can do to cut down the amount of water in your line. We're going to be looking at all kinds of things lawn to do with lawns. And right now I want to set up this great video. This video is called Gimme Green, and it talks about lawn culture in the United States, especially in the arid Southwest. And, well, let's take a look at it. It's a really neat documentary.
Outside of the house, and you can also talk on the pictures and forth. think in your expression of how you feel about life and about the situations and about how you feel about your where you live and your neighborhood, and make it look like someone drives by. That's a nice shirt. It's a fiberglass. It's a junk cold I picked up. And this, you can see where it was patched. That's not even patched. That's not your reseed.
I would do this as he gives out the author of the law, History of the American Obsession, published by the Smithsonian Institution Press. America's attachment to the law is something that was advertised, marketed, imposed on people as an upper class aesthetic. And most people had to learn.
All she had to do was put the script around the outside of the law, and then set the law on automatic. But the law has nothing to do but take a post to a transceiver that feels its way along.
I think most people assume that the law is a natural phenomenon, that everybody has laws, and that's what we're supposed to look like. 1975% of the people in the United States lived in rental houses. They didn't own their own homes. It was only with the spread of owning your own homes in suburban areas that you got the development of the American world.
Right now, it varies as far as market demands, but we're at a 15-cent market price per square foot. So you're looking at what is that, $60? Was 1,600 square feet of grass, probably within 10 minutes, and that was slow.
What might happen is that because your neighbors. Yards are so bad, and yours might be great, but your neighbors are bad. That's going to cause a problem with your sellability. And the sellability factor means is that your home is going to go to the market longer, and it probably is going to sell for less. And that might be because your perception is, wow, you don't have good neighbors. You know, because the yards are wrong.
Hi, I'm Frank Vita from the Arboretum of Los Angeles County, and this is Garza, California, ES350. I'm filling in for Jerry Turner, your regular instructor today, and we were just watching a video that kind of gives you an idea of how huge the lawn culture is. You know, it's just, it boggles the mind how many people have lawns. And we're going to be talking about that. We're going to be talking about lawns. We're going to talk about the reason why we have lawns. And I think you'll find it's going to be a very interesting lecture. Speaking of interesting, I wish I was Jerry right now, because Jerry is in Alaska. Jerry's in Alaska, and he's probably fishing. I'm not exactly sure, but I would be if I was in Alaska. So, Jerry, if you're watching, and you probably are, everything's fine. Don't worry. Just fine. Relax. Go out and fish, okay? Get away from the computer. Alright, so, I am open for any and all gardening questions. I am a technical information consultant at the Arboretum, so you can call me and ask me if you are, have a question about lawns, you have a question about vegetables, your petunias won't petun, your avocados won't avo, call 1-800-339-1193, and I will help you. I will help you with your questions, and that's because I am very questionable today. In fact, I just woke up feeling really questionable. So take advantage of it. Call 1-800-339-1193. I have a calendar item, and let's take a look at the calendar. And that item is... It'll be flashing in front of me in just a second. I see the calendar behind me. And it is... By the way, while we're waiting for the calendar item, if you want to check out anything that's happening at the Arboretum, just go to arboretum.org and you'll find out all kinds of stuff happening there at the Arboretum. Okay, now, here we have, these are from gardening events all over the place, the Chinese Garden Lecture Series, The Edge of the World Visited, Huntington Botanical Gardens, and that's at 1151 Oxford Road, San Marino, which is sandwiched between Arcadia and Pasadena, San Marino. Get off on Allen Street and go straight south, and you went right into the Huntington. Chinese gardening is fascinating. I would really suggest this lecture to you, and I'll tell you why. Chinese gardening is the initial gardening of all, probably of all civilization. The Chinese started gardening first. They developed a lot of horticultural techniques. They developed a lot of items just for their beauty alone. Flowering peaches and plums, for example, were Chinese. Peonies, I mean, the list goes on and on. Camellias, many of these plants had no real commercial value besides just looking good. And they developed all kinds of really fascinating techniques that really just propels horticulture into the forefront. I mean, one of the techniques they developed, and this was a long time ago, was grafting. They know grafting before the Roman Empire. And grafting occurred when brass knives that were sharp enough to do the grafting were available. So Chinese, so I don't know how they figured that out, but they invented grafting. All right, so 1-800-339-1193 is the number to call if you have a question about grafting, about anything. You can call 1-800-339-1193, and I'm going to talk about lawns today. Session is going to be about lawns. Very important right now. Here in LA, we're facing really strict water rationing. I think it's twice a week max on the lawns. This may not bode well for some types of lawns. There may be some brown lawns out there. What can we do? What can you do to save water if you want? What can you do to help make it through these dry areas? What can you replace your lawn with that looks like the lawn a little bit better? We're going to be looking at that, and we're going to be looking at the compelling psychological reasons and history of lawns and why we even have it in the first place. So, let's take a look. We're going to bring up the lecture slides and go through the lecture on this. Lawns, of course, are an obsession with a lot of Americans, and there's some really deep psychological, political, and social reasons for this. Let's take a look at how lawns developed over history. It developed under very cloudy skies. Okay. Well, while we're waiting for that slide to come up, let me just give you a little history about lawns, how they started out, and where they are today. Romans, Greeks, Mediterranean gardens, gardens in Japan, gardens in China really had nothing to the equivalent of a lawn. Roman gardens featured shrubs, they featured flowers. They really didn't have anything the equivalent of a lawn at all. Same thing with the Greeks. The Greeks did have ornamental horticulture, but they didn't have anything the equivalent of lawns. Neither did the Egyptians for that matter. Lawns are kind of a fairly new thing in gardening. They're, historically, they haven't been around. That's because if you think about the amount of resources that they take and the type of, the amount of work it would take to keep a lawn going in ancient times, well, that is a really huge amount of work. We're going to get back to the history lawns in just a second. I see that another series of slides that I wanted to show is up, and this is about lawn substitutes. If you're here in L.A., and you're wondering what the heck am I going to do with this lawn, you want to get rid of it because you can't stand the thing turning brown during water rationing, it's taking too much money, you don't like paying for gardeners, let me show you some alternatives to lawns here in Southern California. Now we have our model here. This is a tiny Kikuyan. She works at the Arboretum with me, and she's going to help show you the different lawn substitutes that are available to you that you can use. Now this is just a regular lawn. In the next slide, one of the big things that you can do for to get rid of your lawn and to have a nice looking ground cover is if you have a large tree, allow the leaves to just stay there. This is the natural way that trees are found in forests. The mulch keeps the weeds down. The mulch, that is, the tree, the leaves, keeps the weeds down. And notice this is an oak tree. Very important for oak trees, even if you want to have a lawn, not to have a lawn underneath an oak tree. And that's because the amount of water that a lawn needs is very detrimental to those oak trees. I think Jerry's gone over that many times. He's very big on not having lawns or anything underneath oak trees. And that's a very good idea. Instead, have oak leaves. They don't look bad at all. Let's take a look at another lawn substitute. If you take a look at this, this lawn substitute is mulch. Mulch is a great lawn substitute. I mean, it's not going to substitute for a huge front yard lawn, but you can bring your plants into the lawn area, shrink your lawn, and in the area where you would have had lawn before, between the plants, put mulch. Now, this mulch here is a mulch purchased from a supplier that is a premium grade mulch. It has a nice color to it. It's probably fresh, looks like fresh hardwood bark. Really nice looking mulch. And you want to use this type of mulch in areas that people are going to see up close. Let's take another look at our next slide. Here's another type of mulch made out of flat oak, and this is a decomposed granite. This particular type, let's take a close up of that. This particular type of decomposed granite has rather large granules, and it's great for this type of landscape. And it takes the place of a lawn and creates open spaces that look bright, that look open between the different plants. This is readily available through rock and gravel companies. It's not inexpensive, but it's not expensive either. And it's a great looking mulch, a good lawn substitute. You don't have to water it. You only water as often as you have to water the plants that are in it. And what you're seeing on either side of the tiny right there are basically aloes, which require no more than once every month watering once there's aloes. So let's take a look at another lawn substitute. This is ice plants. Now, ice plants are a fairly good lawn substitute. Doesn't require as much water as lawns. Once a week is more than enough for most ice plants. It has several drawbacks. One is the large ice plant tends to harbor rats if you don't thin it back every few years. And number two is that ice plants on certain types of hillsides can destabilize the hillside. So if you're going to plant an ice plant on a hillside, make sure you consult a geologist first to make sure that you're not going to bring your hillside down. But ice plant is a really nice, viable alternative to lawns. Same, look at another alternative to lawns. And it's coming right up. And that is, you may not see it closely, but you can't see that. Now, that looks like a carpet, doesn't it? Look at that, there's Tanya, she's very impressed with that. That looks like that is Daimonia marguerite. Daimonia is a relative of Cassinias that's native to South Africa. And when planted and established, it creates a very low carpet-like area. Completely, that's all plant material there. It's beautiful blue-gray. It looks, it can be used as in landscape to replace ponds. Actually, it looks like a liquid. You can make it look like a stream. It can make a nice small-scale lawn. And once it's established, you only need to water it every 2 weeks, max. That takes about 1 to 2 years to get established. It's slow growing. And another bummer, it's not cheap, but I see this as being the next lawn substitute here in California. I remember Dichondra came out a long time ago, back in the 60s and 70s. It was a lawn substitute that looked lower, greener, and actually a lot neater looking than lawns. The only drawback is that it wasn't very hardy, and as a result, it had to be weeded a lot. The type of weed control that was used was a chemical that unfortunately was taken off the market, or fortunately taken off the market. And once the chemical was gone, Dichondra was no longer, couldn't keep it out. And so it went by the wayside. This doesn't have that same problem. Once this is established, you can cut the water back. You do a little bit of weeding on it while it's coming in. And then you have the water back. It looks just fine. And it pretty much curtails all weed growth coming through. Every now and then you may have to go through and pick out a few weeds that usually comes during the rainy season. But usually it's not a problem. Once, as you can see, that one is very thick. It's very compact. It's very tight. And it's an excellent replacement for small-scale lawns. So the name of that, again, is Dimondia marguerite. Dimondia marguerite. Okay, we have another slide to show on that series. Oh, just those beautiful clouds. Yeah, I love that. And now, let me tell you something about this slide right here. I'm glad this is coming up again because this shows you something about lawns that is unique to lawns. Doesn't that look really, really relaxing? Doesn't that just look, gives your mind at ease? Well, there's more to it than you think. Lawns, a huge expanse of lawn, will give you a feeling of security and ease. Why is that? Well, there's a couple of things going here. If you're familiar with feng shui is the art of placement of different items. It's practiced by the Chinese. And what it boils down to is defensible space. If you're in a space that you know you can defend, if somebody can't sneak up on you, and you can wield your sword just fine without anything getting in the way, that's a defensible space. And you feel good being in that space because you know you can defend yourself. You can see people coming behind you. You know, if they don't come from behind you, you see people coming. You can be ready. Same thing with lawns. Lawns are very defensible space, and so they're very calming and comforting to us. That's why we like to have picnics on lawns. That's why we like to relax on lawns, because we can see anything coming at us from a distance. Very important factor on lawns. You can also have that feeling with other plants as well, as long as they have the same kind of scale and appearance that lawns do. Because lawns have such fine blades, that creates an illusion of space. In other words, you perceive that space to be deeper and longer than it truly is. That's why it's so pleasing to your eye. If you go with ground covers that have very small foliage, you get that same effect. You won't get the same effect with ground covers with big, thick foliage. In fact, if you've ever been in an area where there's lots of thick foliage that things can hide behind, it kind of makes you feel nervous. And that's why when you're going for a lawn substitute, you want something that is fine, either fine bladed or fine leaned, so that you have that same feeling of safety and that same feeling of defensibility that you do with regular lawns, which of course is becoming way too hard to keep around. I'm going to go to another video clip, and that video clip dead spot. And we're saying this is a little clip that I did a while back about repairing lawns. Let's go take a look at that.
First, you have to kill the old lawn. That's the end. It goes both first by watering and fertilizing.
spray the tile out there and follow the direction on the conveyor. Well, about 3 weeks to make sure he does that. That is easy to see if he used any areas that need to spray that. Before the next step comes to be reviewed throughout 3 to 5 days in advance to soften the soil. Now, use a saw cutter from the local front yard to measure away the old grass before the rain. When the old grass is off, use a road zipper to cut out some air in your local front yard to chill the soil to the depth of 4 to 6 inches. This is to break up any rocks that are going to need to be removed. Then, rototilling and soil amendments as recommended for your area filing first review. Now, this is an important step. Make sure your sprinkler system is in good shape. If you don't have any even coverage, you wind up having fire dead patches in your lawn. Your sprinkler should be placed by 100% overlap coverage from one sprinkler to the next. In other words, this right from one end should reach all the way to the end next to it. A good test is to place opposite regular vehicles around the lawn. Then, turn on all your sprinklers. Take a good look at the amount of water that comes out at various locations. After all 10 minutes, turn water off and look at all the cups. Each cup should hold about the same amount of water. Keep the water levels in the cups, not even the refiner system. So, after you've taken care of your sprinkler system, carry a sprig of any large plots for any remaining debris. Make sure there are no low areas that attract water. Then, hold the dry soil to settle. Surface. Spray the frosted surface in smooth and uneven patches in 5 feet. The finished surface should be a half inch below rocks and driveways to allow for the thickness of the soil. Next, apply seeds for the fertilizer evenly to the entire area following the directions. This instrument saw a time of the shoes that will reduce take hold and establish faster. You're now ready for the fun part. I will hold your sod. By laying the sod, soon as it arrives, that's when it's freshest. Start on your longest edge, making sure it's staggered each wall so the seeds are offset. Press the edges tightly together. Have the sod fit around the plant to the side plots. Add water like you have for every 200 square feet of egg out. Make sure the new sod doesn't leak. After all the sod is down, you can roll over again. This time, ensure solid contact between the sod and the ground. The last part is easy. Turn on your sprinklers and underwrite it when the sod is good and soaked. In the first week, 5 hours a day, once every 3 hours, at 7 a.m., 11 a.m., and 2 p.m. Then the second week, water twice a day, at 7 a.m. and 2 p.m. Eat 3 once a day, at 7 a.m., then eventually every 2 or 3 days, depending on the weather. Come back to the marathon sod table that identifies the health. You'll find more information about watering, mowing, and fertilizing.
Hi, welcome back. I'm Frankie Dutta from the Arboretum of Los Angeles County, and this is Gardens of California, and I'm filling in for Jerry Tierney, who's in Alaska right now. So, I am very questionable right now. I'm feeling really, really questionable at best. So, if you have any gardening questions, call me right now at 1-800-339-1193. That's 1-800-339-1193. If you have any lawn questions, garden questions, if you're questioning why people even have lawns, give us a call at 1-800-339-1193. So let's take a look more at the history of lawns. Let's go back. Grassland is our safelands. What does that mean? Well, like I was saying before, we feel safe when we're surrounded by wide open spaces. Another thing about grasslands, game in grasslands. Grasslands represent to us as hunter-gatherers the presence of game nearby. Close crop grass means there's something to kill and eat. Some kind of buffalo or deer or other grass-eating creature that's going to feed our tribe. That's why, another reason why looking at close crop grass looks good to us. It kind of appeals to our hunter-gatherer instincts that, wow, there's game nearby. These are fertile hunting grounds. It's spring. This is good for us as a tribe. California has such an appearance. California's wide open spaces.
And this is not so much a wild appearance as one thing. The Native Americans, the Tonopahs, Chumash, which was fire to manage the grasslands and create large open spaces of grasslands. This did a few different things. One, it allowed water to percolate in. Two, the aquifer more efficiently, so it increased the amount of water that they had available in the springs. Two, it increased the amount of game, because grasslands and creatures that eat them are good game creatures. Creatures like antelopes and jackrabbits and other grass-eating creatures are very good, tasty game animals. And number three, probably most important if you're Chumash or Tongva and you're treating with other tribes and you're going down trails, is that fire was used to manage the area to keep the area wide open so you could see if there was a mountain lion or a grizzly bear that wanted to get you. Yep. That was a big predation on humans. It was a big problem in those times. And one of the ways to solve it was to take away the areas where predators like grizzlies and cougars could hide. And that was done through fire management, which increased the grasslands, increasing the open space, the safety of the Native Americans here, and increasing the amount of game that they had to eat. So that sounds like it's pretty interesting. That wide open grassland, you go into the Central Valley, around 1,000 Oaks, that loop is actually an artificial one that was created by fire management for probably 1,000 or more years. Another thing that grass does for your psyche is it gives you that feeling of pride of ownership. Now, why is that? Why grass and lawn in particular? Well, let's take a look at our European roots. If we were rich Europeans, we would have cattle and sheep. And what do cattle and sheep do? Well, they keep the grass mowed down low. So if you're looking out at low mowed grass, that means you probably own cattle and sheep. So that's a good feeling. You have a property owner, you own sheep and cattle. Another thing, another origin of the lawn was during feudal times in Europe. The castle keeps would have areas, small areas of flat growing chamomile. These small flat growing areas of chamomile were used, especially when the castle was under siege, to go down into and drop around it to freshen yourself up, because the smell of the chamomile would displace the other smells, which we don't want to even mention here. And so that was another one. If you had one of these castle keep lawns, you were somebody who was in power. You were either high up in the military or you were one of the royalty. And so there's another reason why lawns bring a feeling of ownership and pride and of status. Now, where did the modern lawn get started? Really didn't get started in castles like that. That's just a precursor. No, it got its start in France. A gentleman named André Lenotre. There's André right there. He was a garden designer. And he created these areas of close-cropped grass that were called tapis verts. Tapis verts. The next slide. Tapis verts were used as design elements in large provincial and royal French gardens. Now, notice the look of this garden. It's very square. It's very linear. It doesn't look natural at all. It looks very, almost looks like an outdoor room. And that was the effect of a lot of the European, the French gardens especially. Was one of an outdoor room. This had very interesting social consequences, and I'll tell you what those are in just a second. A little bit around the same, just about after the French Revolution, during and after, another movement was going on in England that involved lawns. It was totally different than this atmosphere. And that was created by a gentleman named Lancelot Capability Brown. How can you go wrong with anyone who's not a trusted guy with a million capability? Well, Lance Lockett, Billy Brown did something pretty cool anyway. I mean, he just wasn't just trading his name. He designed landscapes for basically the upper crust of English society, the equivalent of who had had their heads taken off in France. Now, he designed something far different than the French gardens. He designed a style called the Parkland Movement. The Parkland Movement integrated elements of the English countryside into English estate gardening. What this meant was that you really couldn't tell where the farms ended and the estate began. Well, what does this have to do with the revolution and politics? Well, what happened was is that because of this design of the estates, the feeling was that the estate owners were mainly they were caretakers of the property. The property really belonged to the English people, and the fact that it did look much different than the countryside really enforced that feeling that, oh, please, all was shady, that this is just, we're taking care of this, it's, you know, it really belongs to England, and so you have this this thread between both the lower class and the upper class, and that is that the farmers would be farming the property that looks just like the property of the upper class. And this is how they would keep England from having a class revolution like France did. Now, they developed this style, by the way, shortly during and after the French Revolution, so it may not be a coincidence that this happened then. But the thing about the Parkland Movement that really got lawns going was the use of natural-looking lawns to create large open spaces between natural-looking elements, like trees and clusters that look natural. And so it integrated into the countryside, and part of that integration was these huge lawns that were between the different elements of landscaping. Now, they would keep these things mowed by grazing cattle or sheep on them. And so there's another aspect to that landscaping that looked like the countryside. There's cattle and sheep in the countryside. There's cattle and sheep in the lower center. Really a nice integration, a nice way to, you know, kind of ameliorate the differences between classes visually. They're very vital looking with those long lawns. Now, here in the States, we had pretty much the same thing going on. We had a style that created large expanses of green and created a communal area for people to do things on. Lawns from this park that's now came over to the United States. Let's take a look at, for instance, Washington's Mount Vernon Estate. Now look at the vast expanse of lawns in that, which were there during Washington's time. In fact, not only did Washington have vast expanses of lawn, he also had a very close cropped lawn bowling green as well at the Mount Vernon. And so that was kind of like the perversions of the green back then. In New England at that time, too, during the colonial time and afterwards, the post-colonial period, large common areas were very common. And that's where they have lawns and these areas where they had picnics, they would have town meetings, events. They were large green common areas, and they created a feeling of communism. I mean, not literally communism, but a communal feeling that, my gosh, everybody owns this. You know, very interesting that that's kind of, if you look at here in LA, we don't see a lot of that kind of style. Also, in one of the things that was America back up until about the middle 1800s, lawns were basically large common areas. They weren't very well kept. They basically let the sheep out on them once a week, keep them down, and that was it. They were kind of almost like having a meadow in the town. They weren't very smooth, they were kind of rough, they needed to walk over. But that started to change. It started to change with the invention of a very important device, the lawnmower. And that was a gentleman named Buddy invented the lawnmower. He got his inspiration from machines that were used to cut carpet. And the lawnmower changed everything. It was right off the bat, you know, it was fairly inexpensive. If you were upper middle class, you could afford one. And this is it right here. This is the first lawnmower. And it allowed a homeowner to to keep their lawn looking really sharp without having to have any animals, which was kind of tough to have because at the same time, we were having the suburbs, the first suburbs coming out, they had, were having large lawn expanses designed in. And the suburbs, of course, didn't want to have animals as well. The suburbs were basically where city dwellers lived when they weren't working in the city. And so this lawnmower was an important development. It started lawn culture as we know it in America. In the turn of the 19th century, saying that this is what your typical lawn would look like, we'll get close to that and I'll discuss this. Now, if you take a look at that, the lawn area is not too huge. The photographer's probably taking a picture from the sidewalk. And I don't know if you can see it here, but that lawn is a really lumpy lawn. Now, Dad probably didn't get out to mow that lawn, but once every couple of weeks with his lawnmower. Because remember, these are good lawnmowers. They were not easy things to do. This is all, you know, quite an arduous affair to go out and mow your own lawn, but it was doable. Lawns had the types of grasses that went into lawns had not really been developed very well. I think back then, bluegrass was popular, and rye, and that was about it. Most of the textures of these lawns was fairly coarse, and they looked good, but not close up. Let's take a look at the early 1900s in Pasadena, see what that looked like. You see, down in Pasadena, the early 1900s, they could probably afford somebody to push around that lawn more often than once every 2 weeks. You can see that's a very nice looking lawn there. And the lawn is used as an element between rather low water use plants. Even back then, we have an agave, we have an Italian cypress there. And it looks like in the back, I'm not sure if that's a, looks like it might be a cedar, but I'm not sure. But most of these are very low water use plants. And they're in the middle of a very water use lawn. So even back then, they still weren't getting the whole idea of compatible planting. If you take a look at flower beds and gardens back then, take a look. Another use of lawns. Now notice how lawns were not used as large expanses here. They were used more like the tapestry. They were used as design elements. Not as common areas. Now this is Pasadena. This is a high-end house. This is, you know, somebody who's very well off. And you notice they don't have a very large common lawn. As they would maybe in the East Coast if they were with a bunch of their neighbors. So here in Southern California, we have a tendency to be more insular with our landscaping. We don't really care if it integrates with our neighbors. It's a lot different on the East Coast. On the East Coast, a lot of neighborhoods have very integrated. If you're watching that video early on, you notice they even have lawn police to go out and make sure that your lawn is integrated with everybody else's. Some communities here have that too, but in the East Coast, in upper middle class neighborhoods, it's a lot more common. Let's see. Now, still, in the turn of the century, we had lawns, we had lawnmowers. Lawn culture was in full swing, it was being marketed like crazy. But we still had lawns that were lacking. One of the most common lawns to be used here in Southern California back in those times was Bermuda grass. Bermuda grass. Dormant every year. And so there's a push to develop new lawn material. One of the gentlemen who developed new lawn material and was very prolific at it was a gentleman named Charles Vancouver Piper. Charles Vancouver Piper was a botanist who loved to golf. What a great combination, huh? He's golf. He loved to golf. He actually worked for the American Golf Association. He was one of the head greens people, and he integrated the government, the agricultural department, to not only develop new lawns for meadows for animals, which is their prime reason to develop grasses, was for foraging, but he also got them to develop grasses for athletic lawns. So the agricultural department supported research in areas looking at lawns not just to feed cattle. But now these lawns were for ornamental purposes. So he got the whole idea of having different lawns just for ornamental purposes, not just using timothy or bluegrass or for forage grasses, using them for lawns. He got the the idea of using lawns for different grasses for lawns. Sorry, I'm researching into those grasses. And as a result, we have a lot of really neat grasses that are being used in lawns right now. Another thing that really kind of pushed lawns along heavily was back in the 20s, there was a huge boom in the popularity of golf. And of course, where there's golf, there's lawns. And this huge boom in the 20s got everybody aware of lawns and lawn culture. And more and more, that lawn you saw back at the turn of the century with the lumpiness and the spots, which was perfectly acceptable back then, was no longer acceptable because in order to draw more people to golf, golf courses create nicer, more flatter, better looking lawns, and that would be their marketing tool. You know, you have a beautiful lawn at a golf course, you don't want to go there. This is the marketing tool they use, and that's spearheaded the way we think of lawns today. Another thing that really increased the popularity of lawns was the post-war home ownership boom. And that's because before the war, a lot of people were, home ownership wasn't considered the end all like it is today. Home ownership was, that was nice, but you could also live in a city in an apartment and have a great time too. It wasn't promoted like it was back after the war. And this is because we had the GI Bill, you get the money readily and very easily to buy a house. There's a huge boom in construction. There's a lot of prosperity. And as a result, lawns and popularity exotic mushrooms in the 20s and just hugely mushrooms in the 50s and 60s. And it became a $1 billion+ market. And it kind of created its own culture. I mean, if you look at even today, if you look at ads for lawn products, they don't go along the same kind of green philosophy that a lot of other products do these days. And that's because people are very, particular about their lawns. Everything else is going to be green except the lawn, which has to be green, and they'll throw anything on it to get it to look good. And hopefully now that is fading, and there's lots of ways to take care of lawns without chemicals. And, Jerry talks about those, he talks about IBM and stuff like that, but the whole idea of having a lawn became competitive. It became not only status symbol, but a competitive status symbol. And it was really important to have your lawn greener, nicer, more healthy, and more weed-free than your neighbors. I mean, it was a reflection on you. And that was marketed, that whole idea was marketed by the large companies that produced lawn chemicals. And it was it's an obsession with a lot of people. So, what's the future of lawns? Right now we have lawn ranges where lawns are grown. As you saw in the Gibby Green, huge ranges where lawns are grown for people to put in new lawns. That has actually increased, by the way, that the advance of sod. People used to have to do lawns by seed, which usually resulted in a lot of weeds right off the bat. You have to have patience and a lot of work to get that lawn weed free through the judicious use of mowing at the right time, fertilizing, and occasional use of weed killer. With the advent of sod, that raised the bar because you can put a weed-free lawn in immediately. And actually, sod isn't a bad way to go if you consider that you get a lawn right off the bat. It is a bad way to go when you consider water. Now, luckily, the technology used for making sod, growing sod in large amounts, can be used for growing grass replacement ground covers as well. And so you'll probably see sod companies investigating and trialing different types of new types of ground cover in the same manner that sod is made. So that's something to look forward to in the future. Will this piece of equipment that I'm going to show you in a second, is that going to be a dinosaur very soon? Are lawns doomed because of the water use restrictions and the turning away from chemicals that a lot of people are doing? I mean, are you going to see this become a dinosaur? Well, like I said, they're investigating all kinds of new types of lawns. Some of the new lawns that are out there are the pest fallows, which are lower water use lawns that don't require a lot. They don't require a lot of water. They do require more water than some of the other ground covers that should do, but they can be watered with salt water. So if you live near the ocean, you can water your pest fallow lawn with salt water. Other future lawns besides cedar pest, I mentioned Daimonia. Future the Daimonia, I have a picture of Daimonia right here in a second to show you that. I do have a call. I need to show you the picture right now because I have a phone call, so I'm going to take that phone call right now. Yes, caller, go ahead. Johanna, how are you doing, Johanna? Hello?
Hello?
Hi, how are you doing?
I am fine. I'm Olya. Hi, I'm fine. It's great.
What can I do for you?
I just wanted to have a question.
Okay. Go ahead, Johanna.
I have a question.
Okay.
Oh. Okay, so a couple months ago, we had here a big fire. And
right.
I lost a couple, how do you call it? Bushes, big oleander bushes. They were about 15 years old.
Okay.
And after that, I have about four of them that I lost. I've tried to replace them.
Uh-huh.
And it's not working for me. I had to throw a couple of them out, and
Johanna, just for a second, I've been asked to ask you to turn down your TV a little bit, turn your TV down. Could you do that?
Yeah.
Okay, great. Okay, so you have oleanders you want to replace?
No. Yeah, am I still talking to you?
Yes, you're still talking to me, yes.
Okay, yes. I like to know if anything will grow underneath that bush, because it keeps on dying on me. The things that I replace doesn't work out, so I wonder if it has to do with the ground or what.
Well, Joanna, what did you replace it with?
Oh, gee, I replaced it with the same thing.
Oleanders?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, well, here's the thing about oleanders. They are kind of, they're doomed. There's a disease that's killing them all off, and even if you got one growing up to maturity, you would probably die very young anyway. So you're better off not using oleanders, which is kind of a shame because, unfortunately, I don't know if you noticed this or not, when the fire came up to the oleanders, Joanna, but did it kind of stop where the oleanders were?
Yes, it
just stops, yeah. It's interesting about oleanders, and there's been several documented occurrences of this where a fire, a huge raging fire, will come up to a row of oleanders, and it will just stop. Now, the oleanders will be burned beyond recognition, but the oleanders have had a fire preventative ability, which is really a shame because, unfortunately, we can't grow oleanders here anymore. So, what you might want to do is replace it with something else that's relatively fire resistant as well. Now,
I mean, how far in the ground is the problem?
I don't think it's a problem with the ground. What I would do, did you take the stumps of the oleanders out?
No.
Okay, you've got to take those stumps out.
No.
You've got to take them out, grind them out, because they're going to prevent a lot of things from growing there, just physically being there. Plus, they tend to, when they're rotting in the ground, they tend to pull in a lot of nutrients from the plants that are around them. So just taking all those oleander stumps out. Be careful when you do, or have somebody do it. Have a landscape contractor do it. Just be careful. You don't want to get oleander sap all over you and then start licking yourself because you get poisoned. Not a good idea. Although these probably don't have any poison in them because they're very old. Is it about 2 years old?
Oh no, they are. Maybe already 10.
No, I mean, how long have they been dead?
Oh, yes, that since fire.
Since when?
Since fire early this year.
Oh, okay. Well, okay, so I would take some caution taking them out. They still might have some juice in them, but contractor do it. And then you can put in several different plants. One of my favorites that I can think of is regularly irrigated, it's fairly fire resistant, would be the brush cherry. Brush cherries, and but you know, fire resistant is kind of a misnomer because anything that's dry enough is going to burn. There's several other plants too that are fairly fire resistant that you might want to try using. Or you can just not, even better, I would just even stay away from using a traditional hedge like that and put in some large aloes. Because aloes are very fire resistant. Yeah, and plus nobody wants to, you know, they're very good protective screen if you have a large wall of aloes. They have spines on them and they're very protective. They're really a neat way to have a kind of a fence. And there's several different varieties of aloes that make great fences. You know, you can go with more than one too. Stick with the bear. The bear actually tends to sunburn a little bit, but there's quite a few other varieties. In fact, the best place to go look at these varieties, if you want to see different varieties, is California Cactus Center, which is in Pasadena on Del Mar and Rosemead. So they're right up north. California Cactus Center. Yeah, they have a lot of different aloes. They can tell you which ones would be good for a living fence.
Thank you very much.
All right, Joanna. Well, good luck. Thank goodness for those those oleanders are there, huh?
Not only that, but I don't understand. I have a huge eucalyptic tree. It surpasses all those embers surpasses the eucalyptic tree, which is about, I don't know, 80 feet high.
Uh-huh.
And yet, the oleander that was about 50 feet away from the eucalyptic tree, that got totally burned.
So the eucalyptus tree wasn't burned? Wow. Do you know what kind of eucalyptus that was?
No,
I have no idea. Usually they don't burn, but there are some eucalyptus that don't burn as readily as others.
Oh.
All right, well, thanks for calling, and when you get that fence in, give us a call and let us know what it looks like.
Oh, okay, I will do that. Thank you very much for your advice.
All right, well, thank you for calling.
Okay, thank you.
All right, 1-800-339-1193 is the number to call. If you have a plant question, like Jonathan, 1-800-339-1193, I have another caller. Yes, caller, go ahead. Hilda, how you doing, Hilda?
Hi, I'm doing okay. I have a question about the UC Verde buffalo grass developed by University of California.
Buffalo grass, yes. What was the question?
My question, is it applicable in our area?
Yeah, actually, it's better in colder areas.
It's a cold area. What do you suggest? What kind of grass shall I put in my backyard?
You want low water use grass?
Yeah.
Well, actually, Bermuda is quite low water use. If you want to go with grass.
Bermuda, even if it's too hot?
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, it'll go brown. If you have to cut back on the watering, it can go brown, but it's just going dormant. It's not dying. And you know, there's a little trick you can do. If you have to come back to watering on a period where it gets a little on the brownish side, you can actually go through with, there's a couple of products out there for painting lawns. You just get green latex paint and go 50-50 on that and spray the brown areas with 50-50 latex paint, green latex paint, and it looks just great. In fact, that's what they used to do. They never really had a great lawn that was year-round in Southern California. All they had was like St. Augustine and Bermuda, both of those went dormant in the wintertime. And so what a lot of places would do was they would go out and they'd use a lawn color on the area and keep it green during the winter so it looked fine. Now when Marathon came out, everybody replaced their Bermuda and their St. Augustine lawn with Marathon, so they didn't have to use the lawn color anymore. So if the lawn color is no longer available, they used to sell it exclusively for grass. I mean, it's still available, but you don't see it in too many nurseries. Now, going back to that, it's a great way to save water. You don't have to water your lawn at all during the winter time, and you don't have to move down any brine. You just color it, enjoy it, and then it comes back up in the summertime. And you have to cut back on the watering, and it gets a little brown again. Just touch it up. That's one of the things.
So you would recommend Marathon?
Not marathon. No, that would be Bermuda. It's the one you want to touch up, you know, colorize during the winter when it's dormant.
Marathon
is a water park. It takes a lot of water to look good. It really is. It's a green grass for areas where water isn't a consideration. But it, unfortunately, in the inland valleys, it requires a lot of water to look good. You have to water these three times a day every week. Now, it'll go it'll go dormant, too, in the summer. And the nice thing about it is it doesn't tend to look as brown, but it will eventually. If you cut back the water enough, it looks brown, too. You can do the same thing with that. You can use the lawn color on that. You just get to use a different shade because it's a darker green. And it will come back, you know, when you start watering again. But it's just to look good. It's not, I prefer, you know, Bermuda, you can go a lot longer between the waterings.
Can I buy it in seeds or in the sun?
With the Bermuda?
Yeah.
Bermuda's best done. There's two ways to do it, but you know, if you get sod, that's the best one. And the other way is using what are called sprigs or stolons. And the stolons are kind of, they're cheaper. You buy boxes of them, but you have to do them in the mid to late spring. That's the only time they're really available. You can do the sod anytime. In fact, what I used to do when I was, me and my brother had a little bit of landscape business when we were teens. And we get the Bermuda grass, put it down, and then we color it. And that was fun. That looked great. And you can put the Bermuda grass down any time, as long as you, you know, color it if it was dormant.
So it only needs three times the watering, three times a week watering?
Well, the Bermuda, you can get by with half the water you do on a marathon.
Oh, okay.
So it takes only half the water to look good that a marathon lawn does. And that's because of the amount of water it transpires. So if you're watering your marathon three times in 20 minutes each, you can go three times in 10 minutes each with the Bermuda. Or two times at 15 instead of the total of 60 minutes of watering, you just go 30 minutes of watering. So it really does save a lot more water than Bermuda does, especially the finer blade stuff. Saves a lot more water than the marathon.
Okay, thank you very much for your time. Nice to see you again in the TV.
Well, thanks. I love you. I'm going to add a couple things after. That is that nice thing about Bermuda is that you can cut that really, really flat. You can make a plain green out of it. Now, the only problem is that you have to get, if you have Bermuda, this is one drawback. You save a lot of water, but you have to get a different type of mower. You have to get a real mower. Not a, you know, I'm not talking about a real man, a real truck, but a real mower is a different type of mower that has the blades. It looks like a push mower, only it's motorized. That's a real mower. The real is the blade, assembly of blades on the front that is in a real. That is the only way to really cut Bermuda, using regular type of blades that they have in normal lawnmowers, rotary blades. Will just mash up the Bermuda and it will get diseases. It won't look good. Don't use it. Use a real mower on your Bermuda lawn. It'll look great. You'll be able to golf. You'll be able to putt on the thing. So, now I've got a video for you. You ever been out and been talking about it? In fact, I introduced this before. Got the wrong video. My fault. I got them out of line. This is the dreaded dead spot. This is how to repair those dead spots in the lawn that you have. And, show up. So let's take a look.
Dead spot. Seed, sod, sod corn. First seed. Pretty simple. Basically boils down to scratch, feed, and cover. First, scratch out the soil about 3/4 inches past the last margin of dead grass. And then take some plant mix, oak leaf mold, a good water absorbing amendment to do. Add that, not too much, to the soil. So, then, tamp that down by hand, or you can use a roller if it's a large area. And then, seed, this is an important part of the whole process because if you overseed too much, that grass is very susceptible to disease. So, go. And let's be good if there's air on the side of less grass than more. Okay. And now our next step is to cover this up. Use the same stuff. They will bleed wool. Take another handful of your amendment. Spread it evenly. Thoroughly covering the seed. You should be able to see any seed now. And have a nice flat now. The next one is sod. Sod, you want to cut the same way as the seed. You want to make sure the depth of that soil matches the depth of the sod. This looks like about half an inch. Also, you want to cut the side straight. It's very important to sod with the end. And lay your sod over, like so. And then use a sharp instrument to sod better. There. Now you want to knit it. This is an important step. So you don't knit it. These large cracks will appear in your patch. And you want to roll it. You want to make sure your roller is half full of water. And then roll over the side. And there. That's time to talk about sod coring. Sod coring is the method of choice for warm season lawns like Bermuda and St. Augustine. It's much like a hair transplant. Go to a nice area of the lawn where there's plenty of good grass. Push your side border down. I've done this before. There it is. And then go over to an area that you prepped just like before. Push this down. So, here, and push down this lever. And then, hit it with your foot. Then you want to do about every 4 to 6 inches for slow growing grass, Bermuda, and 4 to 12 inches for St. Augustine. It all depends on how long you want to weed. No matter what method you use, remember to keep your patches nice and moist for the next several weeks. And remember, vigilance is the key. Don't let them dry out. Your lawn will love you for it.
I want to give you an overview of the 3 major lawn diseases. They are eucalyptus sinensis, parasitic fungi, and water pollution. Now, both of them are hard to identify. In summary, if for example rust, it looks just like a sound. But others might be imperfect, like other stuff. So you have to take a sample down to an expert to get an identification. This is how you do it. Due to the diseased area, located in the area, in your lawn, it's good mixed to bad. In other words, it's diseased here, and good lawn here. When you cut a sample out, square. Take that to a little density and identify something in the tree. Next, I'm going to show you a little bit about tree. I'm going to spray for it. Now, it's very for any fungal disease or pest that has safety is extremely important. That's why I wear rubber latex gloves, keep the chemicals moving into the skin, either a dust mask or a respirator.
Welcome back to Gardens of California. I'm Frank from the Arboretum of Los Angeles County, filling in for Jerry Turney, who's in Alaska right now, probably fishing, pulling in a salmon or a halibut or two. If you have a question or you just want to say hello just for the halibut, 1-800-339-1193 is the number to call. I'm open for any and all gardening questions right now, so call in with your gardening questions at 1-800-339-1193. That's any and all gardening. get questions. And I get questions. That's what I do at the Arboretum. I sit around being questionable on taking in people's gardening questions. And just go over some of them that I've received over the last couple of months that were really interesting. I got one question from somebody who, well, they were having a problem with their neighbor's passion vine coming into their yard. The passion vine was about 2 years old, and shoots were coming into their yard. They wanted to know if they could hit that with Roundup to get rid of it. Well, I had to say no. Why? Because, well, the Roundup would have gotten into their neighbor's plant, and boom, would have killed the whole plant. Not a very good thing. In fact, when you have a situation like that, and say you have a neighbor's tree coming into your yard, you can take actions to keep that from happening. You could, like, cut out your neighbor's tree a little bit, but you have to be careful. You have to be reasonable in what you do. You can't take actions that can lead to the death of the whole tree. Same thing with a bush or a shrub coming in. You really shouldn't take actions that lead to the death of the whole plant. Sometimes that's kind of tough. You can't, because you'd be liable. So, using Roundup on these passion vine aggressors, these invaders, isn't a good idea. So what do you do? Well, it's really easy. You just snap them off as you see them. And in fact, the thing with the passion vine is they only throw out so many shoots for a certain period of time, and then they go into flowering and fruiting mode, and they don't send out new shoots anymore. So you only have to keep that for a couple of months, and it's no longer a problem. So just go out there, snap off the passion vine shoots, no problem. Because remember, it won't last forever, a couple of months at the most, and that's about it. Another question was from a couple. Let's see if I can read this here. As my wife and I grow older, we found that spending the time out in the garden necessary just to keep things looking decent takes a lot out of us. Instead of spending time in our garden exhausting ourselves, weeding, pruning, and cleaning, we'd rather spend it chatting with our grandchildren on the internet. What can we do to make our gardens low maintenance? What can they do to make the gardens? Well, signed Facebook Granddad. These are the suggestions. Dear Facebook Granddad, replace your lawn with low water use ground cover. We've been talking a bit about that during this session. Now, Daimonia was a great example. Ice plants. There are other sedums, all types of low water use ground covers out there that don't take a lot of water, and because they're not taking a lot of water, they don't grow fast, and so you don't have to trim them very often, as opposed to a lawn which requires weekly mowing. Number two, replace all out-of-scale plants with plants that require, plants that require pruning to make them look good. Replace all the out-of-scale plants with plants that are in scale. What that means is a lot of times people will put shrubbery, they'll put trees, they'll put plants in their gardens that are way out of scale. They grow too big for the gardens, and as a result, they have to continually prune them to keep them looking good. Well, if you do a little shopping out there, you go to a good garden center and ask the garden center people, I want something that gets this big and only this big. You can select plants that don't require a lot of pruning because they don't grow very big. They stay in scale. Very important factor in a low maintenance garden is selecting plants that can. Now, luckily, a lot of the large nurseries have been developing plants. I'm talking nurseries like Monrovia and others have been developing plants for just that purpose. And that's because large landscapers, we're talking about commercial landscaping, they have the same problem. They don't want to be out there pruning their plants all the time. And so, but there's been a big push to develop plants, landscape plants that are more in scale, dandelions that are small, junipers that are small, all different types of plants that are small and in scale, so you don't have to be out there pruning all the time. And finally, the biggest thing that you can do, the big things that you need to do to keep your landscape low maintenance is not to fertilize your landscape, and water as infrequently as possible. What does this do? It keeps
stays down. You're not out there brooding all the time. And finally, the last one, the last B for keeping a low maintenance landscape, hardscape. Replace as much as you can. And terrible, but true. Replace as much of the green stuff as you can with concrete. And you have lower maintenance. Now, of course, that isn't the most desirable thing in the world, but sometimes it's the way to go. So, I have a question for you, by the way. I don't know about you, but from during these fires, I've been coughing up a storm, coughing like crazy, and I've been noticing that plants are acting strange out there. I'm seeing plants flowering that don't normally flower. I'm seeing other plants not flowering that shouldn't be flowering. For instance, where I work, the arboretum, the chrysanthemums are late. Now, I don't know if that's the effect of the smoke or the cool summer we've been having, but give me a call if you think you had a problem either with the smoke that we've had from these fires on your plants, or if you had a problem with our cool summer. And then are your plants doing strange things? Are they not flowering when they should? Call me. And also, but for any and all regular gardening questions, so call 1-800-339-1193. That's 1-800-339-1193. Do you have a strange story of smoke afflicted plant? Call me. 1-800-339-1193. We'll take a look at those, and we'll discuss that with you. Another thing I've been noticing, too, I've been getting a lot of calls about avocados not pollinating. And I think that's a combination of, one, the water rationing we've been doing, people are watering them less. And two, I think it's we've had some very, very non-traditional summer. It's been, actually, this summer, the evening temps have been cooler than normal, but about 1 to 2 degrees cooler than they normally are. But we've also had hotter days than normal, so we have this huge, difference in temperatures between days. And I think that's affecting a lot of the flowering of a lot of the plants. It's definitely affecting the avocados. We're getting a lot of fingerling avocados. These are avocados that don't develop because they're not pollinated and you can eat them. We're getting a lot of non-fruit set. Are you having problems out there? Give me a call. 1-800-339-1193. 1-800-339-1193. Again, I'm highly flexible right now, so I'll be in the question. Yes. Caller, go ahead. Paula, how you doing, Paula?
Hey, Frank. I'm so glad I just looked on your program today. And I have a problem and a question for you.
Okay,
I do live in Encino. I'm up here, if you know the area near Mulholland.
Oh, yes.
Makes any difference.
Uh-huh.
And I have a little apple tree that's been in for years and years.
Turn your TV down a bit.
Okay. Then I saw a branch that looked like it was broken because of all the brown leaves, but then I noticed something that really chewed off a lot of bark, and I thought maybe the squirrels, and then I see it's got little tiny holes in the limb. So what could that be?
Well,
it's really chewed up, the bark is.
How's the tree doing besides those chew spots? Is it doing okay?
Yes, it's produced a lot of apples.
Okay.
A lot.
There's several different things that you can be looking at. With those little holes, you might be looking at a little beetle infestation, which can happen, especially if you trim the branch midway. That tends to make the whole branch more susceptible to beetle infestation. Have you had any pruning on the tree?
Not recently, maybe last season.
Okay.
It had fireflies last year, so I took off the tips of all the branches.
Okay, yeah, but sometimes if you take a tip off a branch and it's a large branch and you don't cut it all the way down to where it initiates from the larger branch, that'll put a lot of stress on it and it's more susceptible to beetles. That's one thing. Now, as far as the bark coming off, there's all kinds of critters out there where you are that will eat bark. There's deer, there's rats, there's sometimes possums, there's mice. Small
of the above.
What's that?
I have all of the above.
Yeah. So, but the good thing is that if they're not affecting the area around the trunk, you just see some twigs gone and stuff like that. That might be rats or squirrels.
Okay.
The best way to deal with the rats and squirrels is to make sure they have no access to the tree. So, if you have any overhanging branches that they can jump onto,
from a roof or a fence. Make sure those are cut next time you go through the tree so that they can't get access to it. Generally, squirrels don't, and rats don't like to access a tree from the ground. All squirrels will if they have to, if they don't like to.
But that's where they live, is on the ground, so.
Yeah, ground squirrels. Yeah, ground squirrels can do damage. Where's this damage? Where's the damage located exactly?
Well, it's a branch about, I guess, a half an inch.
Half an inch? But is that high up in the tree?
Not too high.
Okay, so if it's about...
I think there is a compound deep underneath it, too.
Okay, yeah, if it's less than a foot from the ground, it could be ground squirrels. In which case, I would have a professional take care of them.
Take care of what?
The ground squirrels.
Oh, wow. Well,
they can be a real pest. If you let them get out of hand, they can just go out of control.
Well, we have some very active hawks and owls here, so usually people...
Oh, well, yeah. Actually, if you ask them not to use methods that will affect the hawks, they can do that.
Yeah.
Or you can just put up with it. I mean, if it's not killing the tree, you can put up with it, and that's the price you pay for living there.
So, the owls are what, do you think? Is it beetles?
They could be beetles. They're small, yeah, and that's pretty common this time of year on a branch that's stressed from being cut in the middle.
Okay, I'll see if I can...
Yeah, and you'll have beetle holes here on the trunk. It's normal. As long as it's not too overwhelming for the plant, it shouldn't be a problem.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Just keep an eye on it. If Powell's is... By the way, one more thing, I got to ask you, because I have another question. How old is the tree?
Oh, it's about, maybe 40 years.
Okay. You're lucky that, you're lucky because 40 years is a long time here for any kind of, apple or stone fruit or anything like that. So, you know, just enjoy it while you can. Don't worry too much about the stuff because it's blooming way past its prime anyway.
Listen, I wanted to add something for a lady that called and you were talking about Bermuda. Southland Sod, which actually produces Marathon.
Right.
They own that grass. Anyway, they have a Bermuda. It's a hybrid Bermuda called Tiff Green.
Oh, yeah. It's a very good Bermuda.
No, it's just wonderful. It prepares itself, and it's very soft.
Oh, yeah. Oh, it's great. You know, you're absolutely right. It tastes way less water than
it's like a miracle grass.
There you go. See?
Well, listen.
Thank you for verifying. All right. Thanks for calling, Paul. All right. And I have one more caller, and then, Molly. How you doing, Molly?
Yes. Mr. McDonald,
yes.
Last year you helped me with a rose apple. And this year started to bloom, and it had lots of beautiful buds in it. So I covered it with a bird net.
Right.
Because the birds were starting to eat the buds.
Right.
However, so after I did that, the buds started to become yellow. And then brown, and eventually dried and fell. So I proceeded to remove the net, now the tree is reviving again, and everything else. Was there something wrong with covering it with a net?
No, I think what you're looking at is, remember I was talking about the problems you had with the summer. How's it affecting? I think you're just seeing that. I wouldn't worry about it now. I saw that happen. So we have a rose apple at the Arboretum that did the same thing this year. It's just we've had a very strange season because of the huge variances in temperature. Don't worry about that. If it happens again next year, then call me back.
Oh, fine. See, last year I called you on this one because this tree came from Florida. And what it did, it has some round... dark spots on it. And then you told me it was some kind of a fungus or something like that. And I proceeded to cut off the leaves that had those round spots.
Right.
And then the trees did very well. It's in excellent shape, except for what happened. So thank you very much.
Yeah, one more question. Is it getting full sun?
Yes.
You know, I noticed they also, rose apples, they're tropical plants. They do a little bit better with a little bit of shade, so you might want to consider providing some shade to it somehow.
Oh, very well.
Yeah.
Bye.
All right, Molly.
Thank you
for calling. You bet. 1-800-339-1193. 1-800-339-1193. If you have a gardening question, I'm just feeling really questioned. So give me a call at 1-800-339-1193. see, we have, I was mentioning about cutting down your maintenance, and it all boils down to cutting down the amount of plant growth, so you don't have to trim your plant as much. And I don't know if I mentioned this or not, but it's really important, besides not watering and not feeding, be mindful of the kind of compost that you're using. If you want to cut down the amount of trimming and stuff you do, you may want to consider using more inert composts that don't provide too much nitrogen to the plants. And those include some of the barks, they're more inert than, say, compost from a compost pile. Or you may even consider, if you're dealing with California natives, and this is really important actually, you might consider decomposed granite or something similar. I don't know if you were here early on the show. I showed a picture of a decomposed granite mulch that's an excellent mulch for California native plants. There's different types of meshes of that decomposed granite. I like the big stuff. It just looks really cool. We've just about run out of time right now. I just want to thank Jerry Kearney again for asking me to fill in for him here at On Gardens California. He'll be back next week, I do believe, and ask him to tell you a fish tale or two. And I'm sure he'll have some tales about Alaska. And hopefully maybe he'll bring back some tales from Alaska and landscape. What do they do in Alaska for landscaping? So, anyway, until then, this is Frank Dunn from the Arboretum of Los Angeles County. Thank you very much for watching.